Everybody, how are we doing? We get a little wet so far? I have to say, I've come to Seattle now 5 or 6 times, and I don't think I've been here when it hasn't been raining. But they tell me it's been beautiful, absolutely beautiful all summer long here. So maybe I just have to come in different months. But I thank you for trekking up to the theater here, probably in a deluge of rain, in order to get up here and to have a conversation about the role of technology, or the not role of technology, within independent schools. And I think that that's kind of an open question and an open place to start. I'll start today by just sharing a little bit about my background so that you know the perspective that I'm coming to this conversation with. And I understand that probably everybody in this room is coming to this conversation from a little bit different place. And so honoring that perspective that you come to the conversation with, I think is important, and I'm excited to hear from you as we go along here today. So my perspective, I have a background in independent schools. I went to amazing independent schools growing up. I went to a teeny tiny little neighborhood independent school in central Connecticut with 75 students, grades 5 through 9 at the time. My sister actually heads that school now. So it's independent schools, and being in independent schools is kind of a family business for us too as well these days. After that, I spent some time at boarding school in Connecticut, the Hotchkiss School, and then went down to Chapel Hill and Dartmouth to get a couple degrees. Spent some time working in higher education at UNC Chapel Hill in development, and at Harvard helping them to run their secondary summer school program. Then I was an administrator at Holton Arms School for a number of years. I was just telling a couple of folks, I wore a lot of different hats while I was at Holton Arms. I was a teacher, a coach, an advisor. I was also, probably bizarrely, their lower school director for a few months on an interim basis. And I was the director of technology. I think that role as a director of technology at that time was a very interesting one and formative for me, in part because we're still just trying to figure out what the heck to do with this stuff. And I know that a lot of us are still in that space as well. Currently, I'm on the board of the National Coalition of Girls Schools and the National Business Officers Association, and I also chair the High School Review Committee for the NCAA. Give you just a little bit of background also on the organization that I'm the head of. As was noted, I'm the head of One Schoolhouse. We formerly used to be known as the Online School for Girls. That is a part of what we do. We have 4 different components to our work. Online School for Girls, our boys program, a co-ed program called Online Independent School, and a professional development program called Independent School Professional Development. We worked with 233 schools around the world last year, and almost 1,000 educators in professional development in some capacity. So we work with a lot of different schools. We know that all of our schools come to education from unique missions and unique standpoints, and often unique populations, including regional differences in our populations that we're working with. There are also 2 things that you should probably know about me in terms of what drives me, again, coming to my perspective from this conversation. I believe to my core that kids learn differently. I believe that every child learns differently. And I want to honor that promise and honor that understanding in all of the work that I end up doing within schools and with my own school, One Schoolhouse. And I also just love independent schools. I think we do amazing things for kids in independent schools. And I want to work as hard as I can to make sure that the next generation of students has the opportunities within independent schools that many of us have had and that we all continue to work towards. Okay, so you see the title of my presentation today is Technology is Not the Answer. I also believe, and Mr. Torrey, my high school English teacher, might hate me for saying this, I also believe that technology is not the answer. So I believe that technology is not the answer to questions that we have and challenges that we have within the teaching and learning landscape within independent schools today, but I also believe that technology is not the answer. That there is a purpose to technology if we use it for great tools within teaching and learning within our campuses today. So as we talk about technology, I'm going to propose to you perhaps a different why regarding technology than you may have heard before. So I'm going to propose to you that the purpose of using technology on campus within independent schools is to personalize learning to the uniqueness of each student. You heard me say at the beginning, you know, I believe to my core that kids learn differently. to me, the purpose of technology is not certainly for using technology for technology's sake, is not to think about ways that we might be able to engage kids in just cool things, but to really use technology to personalize the learning experience to the needs of each child and the uniqueness and difference of each child. And also at the same time, expand opportunities on campus, maximize the on-campus experience, and allow schools to better reach their missions. Now this last part to me is exceptionally important, to help schools better reach their missions, because that is of course the entire point of independent school education. Right? Our schools exist. Our independence comes from the independence of our mission. I know that over the years, within independent school parlance, it's become kind of seeped into the tradition that independence, the independence of independent schools, has been kind of translated as the independence of a faculty member being able to close the door of their classroom and do whatever they want to behind that closed door. But that's not the actual purpose of independence within our schools. The traditional purpose and the founding purpose of independent schools, and the one that I think a lot of independent schools are trying to go back to today, is figuring out how they are going to deliver on a unique, independent mission that may be different than their other schools in the neighborhood. In fact, I was looking at the Charles Wright Academy website this morning as I was coming over here, or before I came over here this morning, and I just saw this right on their front page. We're for writing the one-size-fits-all wrongs that limit a child's potential. We're for uncovering each child's one-of-a-kind gifts. That fits right, of course, with what we're talking about in terms of the uniqueness of each student and valuing the uniqueness of each student. Let's, though, unpack the second part of this for a second as a group. What can we mean by using technology to expand opportunities for kids? What do we mean by that? Great, so on a simple level, it might be just accessing a resource that they might not have had opportunity to have. Can you give me an example? Surfing the web, right. So it could be as simple as accessing maybe a lecture, right? Or an applet or a game or something like that to help kids have access to something that they wouldn't have.
Or indigenous song.
Or indigenous song, perfect, great example. What else? Yeah?
Some kids need
technology of communicating, so the ability to expand opportunities through giving them different means of communication. Great. Yeah? Yeah, to connect communities outside of where they are. To connect cultures, to connect ideas, to connect people. Great. Especially when we're working with kids with learning differences or learning challenges of different types, giving them another way, another pathway to engaging with content that we may have within a classroom or ideas that we may have within a classroom. Yeah?
It sounds kind of big brother, but it's sort of easier to keep track of how they're doing different.
Yeah, how does that relate to expanding opportunities? Yeah. So it's getting more towards letting the learner drive where they're going. Giving them more data and information, giving them perhaps some of the data and information that a teacher may have within a classroom. That's great. What about that second part here, maximizing the on-campus experience? These two tie together, obviously, right? The access to opportunities off-campus, or that they might not have on campus through technology. But what about maximizing the on-campus experience? What's that really speaking to? Yeah?
Well, our school we're using Google Docs for collaboration in class.
How does that maximize that on-campus experience?
Well, they're working in small groups, collaborating maybe on a presentation when they got one time, because it's all working together on collaboration.
So you might be using technology in order to figure out how, be working with kids so that they can be collaborating in a different way. Okay? What else? Yeah.
Well, I would actually add to that notion of Google Doc. It enables a kind of collaboration they can do on campus, but then to me, really makes you say, how do I best use this face-to-face time? Right? You know, we all know the hard lines in schools, and we all know the gaps that's burned to get everybody there.
Mm-hmm.
Well, how do you maximize that face-to-face precious time that you worked so hard to create now that you put the Google Doc?
Be collaborating in different spots. Yeah, so if you have the ability to collaborate in an off-campus way, what does that mean for the on-campus way? What does that mean? What's best done through face-to-face learning? I know that this is like a crazy question, especially for a lot of you who are coming from purely face-to-face classrooms, right? Like, what is best done in a face-to-face classroom, though, is a key question in this area, because there are actually things that are better done in an online classroom than there are in a face-to-face classroom. We might get to some of those today. But what are some of the things that are best done in a face-to-face classroom that you really want to be doing in a face-to-face classroom?
Discussion, interaction.
Discussion with classmates in a real-time way, right? There are values, and there's value, kind of research-proven value, to online discussion as well. But there is also, of course, value to having this discussion in real time. Great. What else? Yeah. So what do you want to be doing during that time on campus?
So at the time like that, you want to really be focusing on the individual needs of the student.
So it might be working towards the individual needs of the particular learner, knowing what they're struggling with and how to help that individual kid when you can grab by the hand and help them out. Okay, there's that. What else?
You know, I'm for expanding this whole idea of technology. I work in a lower school.
Yeah. So there's two big points to what you're talking about there in terms of just maximizing the on-campus experience is using the technology tools to help kids do, right? And to use the campus experience to help kids do, to be hands-on, to be creative, to be working, to be collaborating in that hands-on way, perhaps building things, makerspaces, et cetera, right, within a school. That's a huge advantage of the face-to-face space. What are some of those other things too? There's the theater program, right? There's parts of the arts program. There's parts of the music program. You can't do some of those things in the online space in the same way that you can do the face-to-face things. There's the labs within a science classroom. There's the building that a kid might be doing in a math classroom in order to explore engineering concepts or something like that. So there are extraordinary things that we can be doing in the face-to-face setting. We all know that. There are also advantages to the online setting. So how can we think about our school setting in order to maximize what we want and using that time to maximize what is best done in person, rather than just thinking of it as the time we have to educate our kids. The third thing there is, how can we help each school to better reach their mission? This, I think, is one of those kind of big questions that will take a lot of reflection and a lot of engagement. So what I'd actually like you to do is, if you have a piece of paper near you, which I know many of you do, or if you have an iPad or a computer screen, we'll work on this too. Go ahead and pull up your school's mission. I want you to actually take a look at your school's mission right now. No doubt your school is working hard to meet its mission. Jot down some of the places you think you're finding great success with that mission. Or just reflect. reflect on it, think on it. And also think about places that the school could be more intentional about meeting that mission. I'm going to give you a couple minutes for this one. Cell phones working well enough to be able to plug the mission?
No, it's the rotten website at our school.
Oh, well, that'll do too.
But we're trying.
So when you look at that mission, think about some of the things in ways that your school really works hard to meet that mission. My guess is you could probably name 20 or 30 of those things off the top of your head. But also think about ways that your school may be more intentional about meeting that mission. Okay, somebody want to share maybe their school's mission and then a thought that they're having? Okay, I'll ask our volunteer. Who would like to share their school's mission? Go for it. Go for it. Yeah.
Things that it can be extra songs that be compassion in the right place.
That's the mission statement.
Yeah.
That's not the motto.
That's the mission.
That's the mission statement.
Yeah.
Great. Think critically. Say that again. Do you see that lived out within the school? Yes. But generally speaking, you see.
Yes, I'm saying we're doing pretty well. Yeah.
What are some of the ways that that mission is lived out in the school? The school has moved intentionally towards much more hands-on learning with kids, more innovative practices, more building practices, all of that.
Yeah.
Is there a way that you see the school perhaps not being as intentional with that mission? You mentioned one area of potential. And I'm not trying to put you on the spot if it's...
Yeah.
Fair enough. Any of your colleagues? It looks like you may have colleagues. Yeah. What does that look like? How do you make sure that you're developing compassion within kids? That's a really tough and challenging question.
I used to think about the service learning component.
Yep. I know a lot of schools are thinking about this too, not just in terms of the what they're doing, but in terms of the outcomes that they're hoping, in terms of really competencies. What are the competencies, the core competencies that schools want their students to be graduating with? Some schools have framed this in kind of the portrait of the graduate that many faculty have worked on over time. But then they haven't necessarily framed exactly how that portrait of the graduate gets pushed down within the curriculum. You can't draw a straight line between the mission of the school and what goes on in a history classroom. Whereas in other cases, you probably can't, right? The innovative teaching practices, the innovative teaching and learning practices, you could probably can draw a straight line from what's going on within the history, from the mission directly to what's going on in a history classroom, English classroom, et cetera. I think that's one of the ways that we might be able to think about how we can use technology on our campus to expand opportunities, maximize on-campus experience, and allow schools to better reach their mission by drawing perhaps some of those straighter lines. Drawing some of those straighter lines and helping faculty and staff throughout the school understand what those lines are. So I want to go a little bit into the how of this right now. And I want to start by saying something that is perhaps controversial, and perhaps somebody might really hate me for saying this. And I feel like I'm going to preface this even before I put the slide up by saying I feel like I can only say this because I used to have a title within a school of Director of Technology Integration within a school. I'm going to tell you, technology integration doesn't work. Technology integration does not work within schools. There's nothing transformative about every kid having an iPad unless you're able to reach higher order thinking, teaching, and learning. If schools take all the technology and use it like a textbook, or just have teachers show PowerPoint presentations or use drill and kill software, they might as well not even have it. This gets forwarded in a number of different reports that have come out over the last couple of years. One of the best ones came out of the Brown Center for Teaching and Learning at the Brookings Institution that talks about the idea to retire being technology alone cannot improve student learning. I think we all kind of are getting to this place within our independent school campuses. And yet, if we know that there's some ways for technology to improve the work in our mission on our campuses, and yet technology integration is not necessarily the way to go, it begs the question, what might we be doing in order to maximize the use of technology on campus in a positive way towards our mission? Emerging evidence is showing us that the way to do this is through personalized learning practices. There is this whole new field that's developing. First of all, how many folks have heard the term personalized learning? Great. So personalized learning is a field that's been developing really over the past 2 or 3 years within it's almost like a next step beyond blended learning. So blended learning has been around now for 7, 8, 9 years. Personalized learning and personalized learning pedagogy has come out of that framework and worked over the last number of years, has emerged over the last number of years. This really has been going on for about 3 years within a public school context, and since the start of the emergence of personalized learning, the Gates Foundation and the RAND Corporation have been tracking the results of personalized learning within about 100 public charter schools and public school systems across the U.S. What they're finding is pretty staggering results. What they're finding is that student success rates are much higher in math and reading testing than in a non-personalized class. And they're finding that longitudinally, as students get more and more used to personalized learning practices, they're in fact getting better and better results in math and reading classrooms. I'll define personalized learning here in just a second too. So we're finding this type of success within this ideal and realm of personalized learning, and yet independent schools have been talking about kind of personalizing their own learning experience for students for generations now, right? That's kind of a core promise of what we say that we're going to be doing for students in our schools. What are the ways that we kind of do this? What's the shorthand for doing that within our schools? How do we tell parents? How do we tell parents that we're going to personalize the learning for their child? We have small classrooms. Yeah, we have small classrooms. We've proclaimed that on our website. We have 8 students for every 1 faculty member within our classroom. We have 6, we have 12, we have whatever it might be within our school. Our shorthand, and in fact, we've trained our parents to understand that we personalize learning for your kids, and we know and love your kids because we have small classes.
Yeah, we differentiate, we group, we do various things.
What's the challenge with that when you're talking about personalization? What if you don't? Okay. It's still not one-on-one, right? We personalize, but we're still talking about a group. We might be differentiating within that group. We might be able to differentiate in better ways than in a larger classroom, but we're still kind of talking about a group. A group to one. We're not talking about one-to-one. We're not talking about true personalization. We're talking about working with a smaller group than a public school teacher might be. It's actually one of the reasons that Pat Bassett, about 5 years ago, told Pat Bassett's former executive director, CEO of National Association of Independent Schools, He told schools starting about 5 years ago, take your ratio of student to faculty off your websites. Stop talking about it. Because what you should be talking about instead is how much you love your kids, how much you know your kids, how well you reach your kids, how you're trying to differentiate or personalize the instruction of your kids. That ratio doesn't actually mean anything. And in fact, it might be hampering your ability to do some of these things within your classrooms. So we're talking kind of in our shorthand independent school way about small class sizes as if that means personalization, but you and I all know that that doesn't necessarily mean personalization. Personalized learning in the path is really associated with three different components. So this is how public schools will start to define personalized learning. They talk about personalization in terms of pathway choice, modality choice, and flexibility of time. So pathway choice, let's think about like what would a content pathway choice be for a kid?
Taking classes in or out of order of the standard progression.
Even within a class, let's even say for a lesson, what would a pathway choice be for a kid? Yeah.
So if I'm teaching a math lesson and I know that there are 4 or 5 of my 27 students that need manipulatives in order to
On a simple level, right, like in a math classroom, you might have a group of kids who's using manipulatives, or they might be able to choose, are they going to be using manipulatives, or am I going to be reading a textbook, am I going to be doing a computer game, am I going to be doing a whatever. All getting towards that same learning objective, but they have choice along the way. Interestingly, I said they have choice along the way. Modality. We're talking about with modality choice. The modal learning, right? Right, could be visual, audio, could be any number of different types of ways. And then flexibility of time. What are we saying with that, really, too?
Some kids need longer words.
Shocking, right? this is like the most basic thing that all of us as teachers and educators know, but we don't necessarily value. Kids take different times to learn things. It's shocking, right? We all know it. It's interesting. At One Schoolhouse, we track with our kids how much time it takes for them to complete any given unit within our classes. And we ask our faculty members to try to create units so that they take about 7 to 8 hours a week in any class that they're working with us on. And we thought, you know, when we track this out, we would see that it would be a very high bell curve, right? That most of our kids would be in that 7 to 8 hour group, and a number of kids in kind of the 8 to 9 and 6 to 7. It was so much flatter of a bell curve than we could have ever imagined. Like a full 33% of our kids were below that. And a full 33% of our kids were 2 hours plus above that. And grades didn't correlate to how much time they spent in class. Well, we all know this as educators, right? We all know this as educators. But we don't necessarily value the idea that kids learn differently. And a big part of that is how much time they're spending. Think about the conversations that you may have. How many of you are administrators? How many of you have had those awful conversations with families about why Susie can take 7 core courses, but Johnny really can only take 5? Right? Like, that's an awful conversation to have with parents. It's not a fun conversation to have with parents. And part of the reason that you know that that's the case as an educator is because Susie really can be on the lower end of that bell curve and get through everything, get through the content, and be able to breeze through this, whereas Johnny needs more time. But telling a parent that without the data is really, really tough. So personalized learning we also see as part of kind of a continuing trend or a continuing movement within schools from teacher-centered pedagogy to student-centered pedagogy, and then from student-centered pedagogy to learner-driven pedagogy. Personalized learning falls in that learner-driven pedagogy way, where the learner has choice over pathway, the learner has choice over modality, the learner has choice over time and has some flexibility. That switch from teacher-centered to student-centered technology, or from teacher-centered to student-centered teaching, is really what we're talking about when we talk about like differentiation, right? That's the shift towards engaging in greater differentiation within a classroom. And one of the great reasons that we wanted to have and want to have differentiated teaching and learning within our classrooms.
Kids are functioning at different levels.
Kids are functioning at different levels. What else? What else do we differentiate our teaching within our classrooms?
They may have learning differences.
Right. Yeah. we know that that can be a little bit different by kid too, right? And so the idea of having a 15-minute lecture and then a 15-minute hands-on activity and then a 15-minute discussion, we know that all of that works well within the way children generally should be engaging with material and dissecting it and taking it in. Great. Yeah? You make it behavior if students are moving ahead of pace?
Yeah, if students are moving ahead or achieve X more material, affect the dynamic.
Depends on probably how you set up the classroom. Yeah. Technology choice in this course, in this case, of course, matters too. I'm just gonna get on a little bit of a soapbox here for a second on this one. A lot of schools have spent a lot of money putting smart boards in classrooms. Smart boards do nothing really but reinforce a teacher-centered classroom and a teacher standing at the front of the classroom. So sometimes the technology choices that we make within schools can actually reinforce the types of things that we're trying to get our teaching away from. So if we're moving in this continuum from teacher-centered to student-centered to learner-driven, that transition from student-centered to learner-driven really is in terms of personalization. It's really what we're talking about in terms of a change towards personalization. To give you a little bit of a visual on this one, a teacher-centered classroom, I don't love this terminology, teacher-centered classroom, I don't love it. And I understand totally that every classroom has elements of this at different times too. But a teacher-centered classroom, basically what we're talking about there, right, is a lecture-centered class with some discussion within the classroom. Teacher-centered, you might think of, you know, a Harkness table or an Oval table, where you have teachers creating enhanced differentiation, and a teacher is part of the learning process with the kids. A learner-driven classroom is where a learner works to meet objectives and competencies, and the learner has control. It's shown here as kind of a scatter plot, because that's what it is. The kids may all be moving in a different direction, while the teacher is part of that movement and facilitating the learning in different ways, depending upon what different students need within that capacity. It's all part of kind of a classroom shift that has started with ideas around blended learning. Some of these things you may have seen before, may have run across before. For example, station rotation models, which I don't know how many of you are lower school teachers, but of course this is all based on lower school concepts of centers, right? Where students are rotating between different types of things. Upper school teachers have finally caught on to the idea that this may be something that they should be doing and maybe something that they could be learning about. I'll tell you that I always think that one of the best pieces of free professional development that a K-12 school can do is have upper school teachers go and visit lower school classrooms, because that's where the innovations and pedagogy are coming from. Station rotation is a pure ripoff of what's going on in lower school classrooms, where kids are rotating between different types of stations that reinforce learning concepts in new and different ways for the kids. Interestingly, for those of you that are not familiar with this, this is not a linear progression. This is a circular progression. Each thing builds on top of each other. It's not, hey kid, you gotta do this station, and then this station, and then this station in this order. It's, they're all going to be reinforcing each other in some different way. Station rotation models often use technology at some level because the teacher can't be everywhere, right? If you have one teacher in a classroom and you're employing a station rotation model, then the teacher's probably only gonna be at that one station unless she already has some superhuman capabilities. So often they're using technology at one of these stations in order to get to a different level of differentiation within a classroom. Another common technique that many folks are familiar with within a blended learning classroom is the flipped learning classroom. We've already brought that up a little bit today, right? Flipped learning classroom, though, I think has been translated within independent schools, at least as I've worked with faculty members, in not great ways. Flipped classroom has tended to kind of drift down into independent schools as you just put some videos up and you have the kids watching them at home. That's not what a flipped classroom is at all, in fact. A flipped classroom really is at home doing individual practice, initial content acquisition, computer feedback, getting some type of feedback as the student is going along, and then doing some formative assessment work. So it's not just putting videos up, it's also embedding in there some way for students to get immediate feedback. Could be taking a quick multiple choice test, could be going through an applet, could be doing something like that. And then getting formative assessment that the teacher then uses in the classroom the next day in order to inform what's going to happen in that classroom the next day. Right? So In a flipped classroom setting, the classroom then becomes project-based learning, content reinforcement, individual help and guidance, group collaboration, summative assessments. Often, summative assessments could also be non-formal too. It's getting towards maximizing the on-campus experience, right? It's trying to use the on-campus experience for what it can be good for, what a number of us noted at the beginning, that on-campus experience can be particularly good for. As you get closer towards personalization, and into personalization, you start to develop these really interesting flex models that I think scare the bejesus out of a lot of faculty members. Because students then have a lot of choice over where they're going and how they're progressing through the curriculum. In a flex model, the student knows what the learning objective or competency is within a particular unit, subject, content area, okay? And a student then also knows where they are in reaching that learning objective or competency based off of some type of pre-assessment that they do. So before going in and assuming that the student has not necessarily had any exposure to a content area, they take a pre-assessment in order to see where they need to go. Sometimes that pre-assessment would say to a student, hey, you need to go back to a prior unit. There is knowledge here that you don't have that is assumed coming in. More often, though, the student will then choose a pathway in order to help them get to the learning objective or competency. And that pathway could be any number of things. Student may decide, hey, I'm going to go to a teacher-led small group, or I'm going to start at a collaborative workstation with my peers, or I'm going to go to a content reinforcement station, or a creative station, or whatever it might be. The student, though, has choice to show how they're meeting that learning objective or competency. Very different. Very different, and yet fully within that kind of progression as we think about flipped classroom and station rotations. I'm going to stop there for questions. Yeah?
So, does this apply to any grade level? Talking about kindergarten?
Yeah. So all these models have been employed with a lot of success at different grade levels. I think the biggest challenge for independent school is defining what those learning objectives and competencies are. And I think that goes back to that mission statement. At some level, the competencies that we want to have students achieve within our schools should derive directly from the mission statement of the school. But we also know that within our classrooms, we aren't particularly good in a lot of schools at curriculum mapping or collaboration between grade levels or understanding what learning objectives are between 7th grade math and 9th grade math or 12th grade math, and understanding that we might have students coming at different levels within there, and so how do you kind of work to show all of that, I think is a much more difficult thing within independent schools. So it's defining what the competencies are, in my mind, starting with the mission, figuring out what the core competencies for the school are, and then building back the curriculum the entire way down through all subject areas. That's ideal. That doesn't mean that that's where a lot of folks start with this. Yeah?
You said that there was a gradient in the math test.
I think that what is being shown is that in personalized schools, grade levels matter much less. So what you're seeing in a program like this is a couple of things that are fighting against traditional independent school constructs, right? One is grade levels, two is schedules, and three is grading systems. Those are probably the three biggest things that this fights against within our schools. And yet at the same time, it probably also opens up new possibilities for us to meet our mission statement. So you see a lot of schools that are moving towards personalized learning practices that start with more multi-level, multi-grade approaches. Also build in much more flexible time into the schedule where a student can be choosing the subject area or pathway that they may need particular help with. and you're getting, even in space within those schools, you know, perhaps 100 kids in the library with 3 or 4 faculty members around being able to facilitate their learning in a different way. And then you eventually start to see schools move towards standards-based grading and other grading constructs like that. Yeah, I think that there are ways around that, though. I think that the architecture is certainly something that, if you were to draw your ideal classroom, it may look different than the classroom that one currently has, but that doesn't mean that it's as big of an impediment as we might take it on to be. Any other questions on personals? So I'm going to bypass the activity here because I think that it's important for us to get in to see what this kind of looks like. So I want to show you just a couple of examples. The first one is from a class, I'm sorry, it's a little fuzzy, but I'll spell it out here for you. The first one is in a class that we teach, our AP Calculus BC class at One Schoolhouse. So this is a traditional content objective for an AP BC Calc class, where students are going through trigonometric functions. And in the lesson materials that they have, their objective, so that I'll read this because my guess is you can't see it, I can barely see it from here. By the end of this lesson, you will be able to solve for derivatives of functions involving all 6 functions. Okay, so they're doing this. In order to access the content, they have 4 different pathway choices. They have the choice of engaging with their textbook, going through a number of applets, going through a PowerPoint on this topic, or watching a couple of video presentations on this topic. We find, as we know where kids are clicking on this, that they end up typically choosing 2 or so pathways in order to engage with this. But they have great choice in how they're accessing the content originally. Think about the change between that and a teacher-centered classroom in a typical independent school where a faculty member is standing at the whiteboard and showing kids how to work through these functions. They're showing one way. Instead, these kids have 4 different ways that they can choose. Think about the time. The faculty member standing in the front of the classroom spending 25 minutes doing this, some of these applets might only take 5 minutes, and that might be all that kid needs. So you're potentially saving the kid time, you're giving them choice, and you're figuring out for them, you're helping them learn how they learn. These kids, by an end of course like this, understand what types of modalities are and pathways are going to be helpful for them. Which is, of course, getting back to one of the greatest promises of independent schools, that we will develop lifelong learners and a lifelong love of learning. So in addition to that, even before that, the kids are told through their pre-assessment, hey, if you're having trouble with any one of these, you need to go back to one of these units. If you're having trouble in your pre-assessment and a review of solving some of these types of equations, you need to go back to these other things before you even begin with what you're doing now, because you're going to miss it. Again, think back to your traditional AP Calculus, BC Calculus class. Is the teacher going to stop and identify that immediately before the lecture begins? And how could they actually do that if they're dealing with a class of 12? Even a class of 12, they couldn't do that. So how can you use technology to potentially maximize the experience for the kids and maximize the learning for the kids? This, I think, starts to get there. Yeah?
Question, so this is something that the teacher created then, right?
Yeah.
And then, does this take teaching students how to navigate this?
Yeah, it does. Yep. So part of the thing we do actually with the kids right at the beginning is we talk about the ways that they learn. And we do a whole kind of orientation session with them. Let's go through how you learn best as a learner. And then the teacher sets a learning objective with the kids. The kids actually set a goal at the beginning of the year about how they're going to learn. And the teacher then will touch base with the kids if they're seeing that other pathways may be more successful for them. Right? I see that Susie is struggling because she keeps going to applets. She may like them, but it's not really actually helping them learn, and so I need to help Susie figure out what pathways can be more effective for her. other thing, and this gets to a big question that I think a lot of teachers have in this type of stuff, is you know that you don't see the teacher creating 25 videos to do this. They're curating content in a different way, right? So one of the big kind of barriers that a lot of faculty members have as they start to think about this type of stuff is, oh my God, I'm gonna have to create 150 new videos to show them every different thing. In fact, no, you don't. And we all have always known, go back to when we took calculus back in high school too, right, or college? We knew that some teachers, the way that they were describing things to us just didn't work. But we knew that another teacher, if they explained it to us, especially often math, it did work. So if you're curating content as a math teacher, as a physics teacher, as an English teacher, as a whatever teacher, then you can actually show the kids two or three different ways that teachers have already put videos out and how to solve that type of problem. Yeah. Right. Louder.
In looking at this, I'm assuming that the summative assessment or the demonstration of mastery would also have a variety of options.
It totally may. It may not, too, depending upon what the competencies are that you're trying to accomplish. For example, in an English class, almost every independent school that I know is going to be asking, or in history class, is going to have kids write some substantive research paper. That is a core competency that kids probably still need to be able to come out of our high schools with. So therefore, in some cases, there might not be that choice.
But then that's the actual learning objective itself.
Exactly, bingo. It's the competency. And it's an intentional competency. Rather than, sorry.
You said that the learning objective, for example, is to understand
That's exactly right. And actually, this is one of those places, I'll tell you more about this at the end, but we actually do this within our professional development classes too. We personalize our professional development classes so that faculty can get a sense of what that looks like in the student role. So that when a faculty member goes in, they have to do a check for understanding, right? A formative assessment, to show us that they understand what they know from the unit. And then they have to apply their knowledge, but they have choice in how they're applying their knowledge. That's often how you would do this with a kid, right? You give them choice in how you're applying your knowledge to show that you've met that learning objective, to show that you've met that competency. That's great. Any other questions on that? So what does that start to mean? And I'll tell you just also, especially for the administrators in the room, for us this is not, I know that this is not an overnight thing. This is not an overnight transformation for a lot of schools. This is something that takes a long time to do. For us at One Schoolhouse, this was a 3-year process with our faculty. We worked on what we think is most essential within independent schools to begin with for a full year. What does it mean to develop student-teacher relationships online in that space? Then we worked with our faculty on formative assessments, and then we worked with them on student agency, what student agency looks like and how you develop that within an online space. So for our faculty, it was a 3-year journey to that place. At this point now, we've actually given up having a specific faculty theme because we've personalized all of our professional development for our faculty members too to help them reach the competencies that we've set. So within our teaching and learning standards for our faculty, we've developed a series of competencies so that our teachers know what the competency is, what we consider baseline effectiveness to be within that competency. We consider to be exemplary implementation, and then to have them show to us the examples and artifacts that they have along the way. So this is just an example of that. But in this competency, for example, teacher builds an authentic relationship with each student as a cornerstone of the learning experience. They have to show baseline effectiveness within this area. And to do that, they build learning partnerships with students based on mutual respect and trust. And they know their students' goals and learner profile, actively working to support growth through regular contact and feedback with students. That's a gift to kind of, we require all our faculty members to do work with the students at the beginning of the year on goal setting. Exemplary implementation means they connect feedback to data as a foundation for growth. So they're using data in order to understand the depth of that relationship and to impact how that relationship can improve. And they anticipate learner challenges and proactively engage with students to strategize or troubleshoot. So they show us how they would do these types of things. So we've built a number of competencies for our faculty members that correspond with where we're trying to get the program to go. If a faculty member needs help in any of those areas, there's specific professional development that helps them meet that objective in a different type of way. So what does all this mean for a school? Well, I'm going to give you an example of a school that started to think about this pretty carefully. This is St. Andrew's Priory School in Honolulu. I'm giving you a good reason to go out to Honolulu, especially in the middle of winter. So go ahead and go back and tell your heads of school that you need to get to Honolulu to see St. Andrew's Priory. St. Andrew's Priory is a really interesting school in that it's a small school in downtown Honolulu. And if you know anything about the independent school market in Honolulu, it is a very robust and challenging market dominated by big schools. So there's Punahou School, there's Iolani, there's Kamehameha. These schools have thousands of kids in them and have big, huge campuses with 45 tennis courts and everything else. There is no way that this little school could ever be that, right? There's no way. It has literally one block of land in downtown Honolulu. The cool thing, though, is that that block of land is right next to downtown businesses, across the street from a major medical center, across the street from the state legislature, and has a major university three blocks away. That's an advantage. That's an interesting advantage. So they've tried to figure out how they're going to use technology on their campus to maximize the on-campus experience, expand opportunities, and to think about and to further the mission of their school. A lot of that means getting their kids off their campus. In order to do those things, they know that their advantage is getting the kids off the campus. So what does that mean in terms of expanding opportunities? It means figuring out ways to free up their schedule so that they can be off campus. It means having kids take more online courses. It means building blended learning capacities within schools. It means changing even some of the buildings in schools to be more about the things that they can do best on their campus. It also means, in their case, anyway, get a little bit of the point here, right? They are trying to figure out how they can do what they can on their campus best, but then get kids off in order to meet their mission. They build competencies also on their campus that relate to things off campus, because they understand that the learning that the kids are going to be doing is going to be more and more off the campus of their school. Any questions about that example? I'm going to leave you with just ways that you can continue to use us to help if it's helpful. We do have a number of free resources up on our oneschoolhouse.org website that may be helpful and may build out some of these in a little bit greater detail for you. We have a learning innovation blog that talks through a lot of these challenges and the ways we've developed them. We have a whole set of videos up on our website that walk you kind of step by step through different components of personalized learning. And then we also offer online courses that help do a deeper dive into this stuff. I'll take any questions that we have, or thoughts, or ideas, or challenges, or anything else. Well, let's break down what the concern is there too, right? Because the concern comes from different places. The concern comes from families wanting to spend more time together. Families rightly, focusing on that in a different way. There's a great study actually just last week that was released about how families are actively trying to spend more time with their kids. Parents are actively trying to spend more time with their kids in developed countries. Awesome. So homework itself fights against that. And yet at the same time, parents have an understanding that homework may have a place because of their own school, right? So there's this understanding that homework helped in their own personal development. But there's not kind of the intentionality behind the homework assignment that a lot of parents are looking for and a lot of kids are looking for too, right? So if you're starting to think about things like pathway choice and flexibility of time, then you're opening up more opportunities. But it means a greater intentionality on the part of the school and on the part of the faculty member in order to get there. I think you're right, though, that with those two things, you can get to a place where parents can understand the purpose of homework in a different way, and can probably see some relief for some of their kids. But yeah, I mean, every parent complains about it. Why do they have to do 1 through 19 odd in their math textbook this night? They don't. Sometimes they do. Thank you. No, sometimes they do. But sometimes they don't, too. And sometimes the kid's going to get it after 7, so why are you having to do 1 through 19?
Or you might argue that dividing between class time and homework is sort of a false division. If it's all about achieving certain competencies,
I think that's right on.
That might, and yeah, so, and I think you, speaking of the technology, you now have that whole thing operating, which I think takes a lot of time to be social online and all that.
Yep.
So it's, but there's great opportunities that I think.
There's great opportunities that I agree. I think you're right that there's a false division between homework and in class time. Yeah?
Sort of diagrams of different types of learning. The one for personalized learning would kind of like scattered with dots. Where everybody seems to be.
No, because I think you build that into the competencies that you want kids to have. So I think you make that one of the end goals itself. Does that make sense? So there's an intentionality not just behind what they're learning content-wise, but how they're doing it. And you build one of those competencies being shared perspectives, engage as a group, build something out as a group, create something together, those types of things. But there's an intentionality behind it rather than it just being a group project.
Do you ever, when it comes to differentiating how they're going to present their work, do you ever do anything that is performance-based?
Sure.
And how does that work out? Because I know last year I was working with third grade and they're hiring a teacher. So they're working on a song. So in the regular classroom, they did a poem and putting music to the poem. The problem I had last year was I had 15 to 20 students come to me. Probably at the same time, I felt like, Mr. Lucero, is this right? Mr. Lucero, listen to this.
Right.
So how do you get that not to happen?
Yeah, no, I don't know that you're not going to get that not to happen within that particular scenario, right? But you do want to give the kids some type of tools to understand where they are within their own process too, right? So that they don't have to come to you for the check on that. They can potentially go some other place for the check on that, or they can self-check. Right, and so building some of those things in might be helpful. I understand that that's potentially more difficult to do within music than other subject areas too. You don't have applets that you can send a kid to figure out whether they're getting, you know, give them immediate feedback or whatever. I get that. Yeah?
What's your perspective on cross-curricular projects like between classes? And sometimes it can, I think it's obviously a good idea, but it can be hard to assess.
Yeah.
To me, it goes. You do a research project that could be on your Ken class, your history class, your English class. Well, where's the grade come from?
Yeah, I don't know. I think it depends on totally the school. But to me, it kind of goes back to, again, competencies that you're trying to instill within kids. And if you have a competency that is reached well by having a chemistry teacher and an English teacher work together on that, then it seems to make sense to me. But it kind of goes back to that. One final thought I'll leave you with too, if you want to take a look at an independent school that's kind of taken on personalized learning full on, you may take a look at Acton Academy, which is a fairly new independent school out of Austin, Texas. They're starting to have different locations too for their schools. And I'll share this with you too. They have up on their website an Acton Academy Day in the Life, where they talk about what the student experience is within a personalized class. Put aside that this was produced by the school and that there's a little bit of a marketing angle to this, you all are smart enough to look past that, and dig into what it means for a kid to go to school when they know that they have certain learning objectives that they're going to meet, that they have different pathways to meet those learning objectives, and that they have more choice and purpose over their work. So I'd suggest, I'm sorry, that didn't show up. I was hoping that that would, let's see if I can get the, I can't get it to show up. Come on up afterwards, though, I'll show you. It's just called Acton Academy, A Day in the Life. If you YouTube that, go on YouTube and just type that in. It's gonna come right up.
A-C-T-O-N.
Yep. I think the powerful thing, and if we have more time, I'd show it to you, and then we can debrief on it. The powerful thing to me is that it speaks independent school language, so it will be familiar to a number of you, yet you'll also be able to quickly identify the places that their way of teaching and learning looks different than a traditional independent school. Thank you all for taking the time with me today.